Is this man Coniah, a despised, broken idol, a vessel in which is no pleasure? Why are they cast out, he and his descendants, and cast into a land which they do not know? O earth, 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 hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord, write this man down as childless, a man who shall not prosper in his days, for none of his descendants shall prosper, sitting on the throne of David and ruling any more in Judah. Now, there are four main arguments that are used in order to either deny Jesus Christ the right to the throne or to establish that he has the right to the throne, such as the dispensational premillennialists will do, in terms of sitting on a literal throne in Judah. And also, we need to look at it from the Christian perspective. In other words, from the perspective of those who understand the prophecy in a different way, that Jesus does have the right to the throne, but not a literal throne upon which he would reign. So let's go ahead and let's take the arguments one by one. All right, the first argument that is made is that Jeconiah prospers because he has children. You know, they are saying that this curse that was placed on Jeconiah was lifted. And, of course, both Christians and some Torah-keeping Jews would say that the curse of Jeconiah was lifted. Some conclude that because, he had children, this was a reversal of the curse. Now, you may know that Jeconiah is listed in the genealogy of Christ in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 12. So that would suggest to you that if he's in that genealogy, there had to be people who came after him, and therefore he has children. And since David and Joseph are in that genealogy as well, then, of course, Jesus is a descendant of Jeconiah because, of course, he is of the tribe of Judah. And so they're saying because he had children, he does prosper. In 1 Chronicles chapter 3, 17 through 18, we find that his sons are recorded in that chapter. It says, and the sons of Jeconiah, and please don't hold me to these pronunciations, and because I'll just make myself look stupid. But he says, and the sons of Jeconiah were Asher, Shealtiel, his son, and Malchiram, Padiah, Shenazar, or Jechemiah, Hoshama, and Nedabiah. I guess I could have saved myself the trouble in even attempting. But this statement has led some to believe that the curse was lifted. And they reason, well, if Jeconiah had children, how was he yet under the curse? Now, I'm going to come back to this. So I just wanted to get it out there that you understand that this is one of the reasons why they say the curse was lifted, and therefore it gives Jesus the right to reign on the throne in Jerusalem. Now, that, of course, would be a dispensational premillennialist argument, that if he has children, the curse is lifted, he has the right to reign on the throne in Jerusalem. Now, the question, however, is, was Jeconiah restored to his throne by the king of Babylon? This leads us into the second reason that it's believed that the curse of Jeconiah was lifted, and that is his restoration by evil Merodach, who was the Chaldean king or the Babylonian king. Was Jeconiah restored to his throne by the king of Babylon? Now, we do have a text that says there was a reversal of some things related to Jeconiah. The Bible says in 2 Kings chapter 25, verses 27 through 28, now it came to pass in the 37th year of the captivity of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, in the 12th month, on the 27th day of the month, that evil Merodach, king of Babylon, in the year that he began to reign, released Jehoiakim, king of Judah, from prison. So before he was in prison, and now he is released according to the text. And so it is concluded that he's restored to his reign. Well, let's look. The Bible says he spoke kindly to him and gave him a more prominent seat than those of the kings who were with him in Babylon. So Jehoiakim changed from his prison garments, and he ate bread regularly before the king all the days of his life. Again, that's 2 Kings 25, verses 27 through 28. Now, let's analyze this a bit. Is this saying that the curse was lifted, that he was no longer subject to the prophecy that Jeremiah made concerning him, and that no one of his seed would prosper sitting on the throne of David and reigning anymore in Judah? Was Jeconiah restored to his throne by the king of Babylon? This argument that Jeconiah is given a more prominent seat than the other kings with him is not, as some propose or believe or teach, a restoration to his throne. In fact, it is proof that he has not been restored, that he was not restored. In other words, what king lives off the welfare of his captor? Why was he dependent upon evil Merodach to feed him if he had been restored to his reign, if the curse had been removed? What king lives in captivity to another? The prophecy stated, "But to this land which they desire to return, they shall not return." And it also stated that he was going to die there. So he wasn't restored to his throne in Judah. He was simply given privileges above other kings that were yet in captivity in the land of Babylon. And since God said he was going to die there, we certainly can't conclude that the curse was ended. Now, therefore, part of the curse on Coniah, or Jeconiah, prevented his return to the land of Judah. And therefore, it was because he was yet under that curse and restricted by it to return. And to argue that he was restored and ignore what I believe is this vital, essential part of the curse is an attempt to connect dots and to close circles which cannot be connected or closed. Then we have another argument, and that is, and this kind of goes back to the one where I said I'd come back to it, regarding his descendants, because they say, here is proof that Jeconiah and his seed, or that his seed reigned. They said, apparently he repented, which we have no objection to that he repented of his sins. But here's the point. They're saying Jeconiah's grandson ruled as governor in Judah, and that is proof that the curse was lifted. Well, let's examine that. What they're talking about is Zerubbabel, who is Coniah's grandson, being made governor of Judah. And if we go to the book of Haggai, Haggai chapter 2, and the verse is 11, the Bible says, "In that day, says the Lord of hosts, I will take you, Zerubbabel, my servant, the son of Shealtiel, says the Lord, and will make you like a signet ring, for I have chosen you, says the Lord of hosts." Now, here's how the argument goes. They say, well, you know, the signet ring was that of the king. And because Zerubbabel was given this signet ring, that demonstrated his regal reign, if you please, and basically confirmed him or established him as one who was the seed of Jeconiah, and therefore indicating that the prophecy or the the curse had been lifted. You know, there's a saying that says that which proves too much proves nothing. And I believe that that is what we have here in this scripture and with this text. So let's look at it a little bit more closely. When we examine this text about Zerubbabel, we find that the text is misapplied. First and foremost, it is not a reference to Zerubbabel in the time that he lives. In other words, it's not a prophecy that is establishing him as a regal descendant of Jeconiah, but nor does the prophecy occur in the governor's lifetime. When you look at this text more carefully, what we find is the text is prophetic, and it looked beyond the governor's lifetime to that of the end times. The governor is given a prophecy concerning the shaking of heaven and earth and the overthrow of the Gentiles.